dancing program from the Paradise Restaurant in the Great White Way of Manhattan, New York City, played by Glenn Miller and his orchestra. On the afternoon of December 15th, 1944, a single-engine Norseman C-64 with one-way radio, fixed landing gear, and a poor reputation for standing up under tough weather conditions took off from England for a short flight over the English Channel bound for France. The plane was airborne in a ceiling of less than 200 feet. Nothing more was ever heard about the plane or the fate of the service personnel aboard. One of those passengers was Major Glenn Miller, the most fantastically successful of all the big band leaders during the golden days of the big band. Now, exactly 25 years later, WTIC proudly presents Glenn Miller, a memorial. Good evening, this is Arnold Dean. Tonight, with an assist from such Glenn Miller friends and associates as big band authority George Simon, Stanley Aronson, who was once a member of the Miller Orchestra, and the incomparable Tex Beneke, we'll recall Glenn Miller, the man. And through the great legacy of unique recordings he left behind, we'll hear more of the sound of Glenn Miller. George Simon is acknowledged as the big band authority and as a great personal friend of the late Glenn Miller. And now, 25 years after his disappearance, George, I imagine you're doing some reminiscing.
Yeah, matter of fact, Arnold, I'll never forget what happened when I first heard about it. It was a tremendous shock because, as you know, the news of Glenn's disappearance wasn't released until just Christmas Eve, very close to Christmas Eve. And I remember at that time I was living in Manhattan. I'm now living up in Connecticut, in Stamford, by the way. But that time I was living in the Village, and I remember picking up the evening paper and reading about it and walking down to Washington Square and hearing the Christmas carols going on down there. And the whole thing seemed to be so incongruous, I broke up.
I can imagine. Yeah. You'd known Glenn for many years, hadn't you?
Yes, I first met him when he was in the Ray Noble Band, and I joined Metronome, which is back in 1935. And I remember the Noble Band was playing at the Rainbow Room, 65 stories near the stars. Remember, they used to say that on the,
yes,
the announcers in Rockefeller Center. And I used to go back as a young Cub reporter backstage to talk to the guys in the Noble Band, because there's so many wonderful musicians, Glenn and Charlie Spivak and Claude Thornhill and
Will Bradley,
Bud Freeman, Johnny Mintz, and a whole bunch of guys were in that band. And for some reason or other, Glenn and I gravitated towards one another. And I remember at that time I was living at home with my family in one of those brownstone houses on the west side, and Glenn used to come up and sometimes bring Charlie Spivak with him for dinner. And the family, which was pretty long-haired family, long-haired in the classical tradition, that is, really took to Glenn, because he was a very down-to-earth, very intelligent, bright guy who could fit in with any group of people at all. He used to fit in with classical people. He used to fit in with the young kids. He was a very easygoing man in many ways. That is, until he started getting into business. As a businessman, he was very, very strict. Of course, it's interesting that the stuff that his band did not sound too much like the things he had done for other bands. The things he did for the Ray Noble Band and for the Dorsey Brothers Band was quite different from the stuff he did later on with his band. And even the first records we made, the ones on Decca, I say we because Glenn got me to play drums on that day because I couldn't find anybody else who knew the scores, I guess. And they were quite different sounding from the ones that came along later on when he had the clarinet lead.
Uh-huh. Isn't it interesting that you mentioned the drumming? I know from having read, I think a great many articles that you've written about it, the percussion section was the one area where Glenn seemed to have persistent trouble.
Yeah, I know it. And if you play any of the things from the Army Air Force Band, I think you'll find a vast difference, because that was a great rhythm section, the one with McKinley and Trigger Albert and Mel Powell and Carmen Mastrin. civilian rhythm section is infinitely better than the one I played in.
Glenn, when he did strike out on his own, sought your advice very frequently, didn't he? Because he had some trouble making it click.
Well, yes. I don't know whether he sought it out, but I was around so much because we were such very good friends. He and Helen and I were quite good friends. And naturally, being with Metronome at the time and getting around every night to hear musicians, Glenn found it advantageous, I guess, to stick around with me. And of course, I loved sticking around with him. I got a big kick out of being in the formation of the band. We came up to Hartford, we know, one time before the band ever started. And we'd gone over to Cornwall to hear Hal McIntyre. Mm-hmm. We met Hal. It was a very bitter cold night, I remember. And I was very impressed with Hal because he drove around with a Model A Ford with no top on it, as I remember, in 0 degrees weather. And we went into Hartford, and we went to a studio, and Hal brought his band. He had a band up there at that time, and he wanted Glenn to hear the whole band. And he wanted Glenn to take the band as the nucleus of his band. But the only one Glenn was interested in was McIntyre, who, by the way, arranged on the first recording date. He arranged a thing called I'm Sitting on Top of the World, and played jazz clarinet. In those days, he was a jazz clarinet player.
Uh-huh.
And then... But there was no need for a jazz clarinet player in the band. And then, of course, later on, Glenn had Fazola, who was his idol. Glenn was crazy about Fazola as a jazz clarinetist.
Mm-hmm.
But you'll find very little jazz clarinet playing in the band. Ernie Caceres once in a while.
Who was his idol as a trombonist? I imagine it was Teagarden.
In a different sense, he had one trombone player he told me time and again that he thought was the greatest of them all, and that was Will Bradley.
Ah, yes. That's the man he played next to in the Ray Noble band.
Will Bradley was his idea of the complete trombonist. He loved Jack Teagarden's jazz, and he loved Tommy Dorsey's facility and tone and sweet playing, and he liked Jack Jenny's soft sound, and there were others he liked also, but Will Bradley was the man he always looked up to. There was a big Daily News bash at Madison Square Garden, and Tommy's band was there, and Will Bradley's band was there, and Glenn's band was there, and for a finale, they played the Don Redman arrangement of I Got Rhythm, which has a three trombone chorus in it. And Glenn and Tommy and Will Bradley played that chorus together.
Wow.
And on the way back, we left there together, Glenn and I did, and Glenn turned to me and said, you know, if Will hadn't been in that group, we never would have been able to make it.
George, was Glenn Miller a difficult man to play for if you were a member of his band?
Not if you stuck your nose to the grindstone. He was quite a disciplinarian, and if you didn't follow suit, I guess you could call him the Vince Lombardi of the band leaders. He knew exactly what he wanted. He knew exactly how to go about it, and he wanted no foolishness, although off the stand, it was a lot of fun in the band, but on the band, it was strictly business. Everything was routine, and clockwork, and when Glenn wanted to rehearse the section, for example, he'd go right into the section with his trombone and show the guys exactly how he wanted things phrased. I remember sometimes he'd even have the sections rehearsed without a rhythm section because he felt that any section should be able to swing by itself whether it had a rhythm section or not. And thank God he did that because with that rhythm section he needed a swing.
You're listening to Glenn Miller, a memorial, on WTIC in Hartford, Connecticut. Do you think maybe this is one of the reasons why the band still holds up today when you listen to the old recordings?
I mean, the fact that the ensemble sounds, I mean.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Very few of his imitators ever got those ensemble sounds.
Uh-huh.
They never had the tightness. But Glenn was never, you know, having a jazz band was not his aim. Having a commercial band and a good musical band were his aims.
Thank you.
somewhere in another world alone with you, sharing all the joys we used to know. Again, your face comes back to me, just like the theme of some forgotten melody in the album of my memory.
Serenade. I hear you say forevermore, and then the song became a sigh. Forevermore became goodbye. But you remain in my heart. So
tell me, darling, is there still a spark?
I think he sort of felt a little hurt when people said his band didn't play good jazz, but it didn't make too much difference to him because that was not his primary aim in life.
Well, you can't be all things to all people.
Right, yeah.
George, let me ask one thing, and I don't know if you can even answer a question like this. Maybe it's too all-encompassing, but is there any special experience that you are recalling now as we observe this anniversary time? Anything in your previous experience with Glenn and all the years that you knew him that stands out above the other things?
There's so many things, but I don't know why this came to mind, but this is something that happened, a rather personal thing that happened between Glenn and me. It showed me the fact that this is a guy who wanted instant decisions. It occurred, I remember one time but we were riding under the old 3rd Avenue L, and he was driving, and I had been made the first record with the band, and I was also writing for Metronome at the time, and he said, you know, you better make up a decision right now about your future. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, are you going to stick with the band and play with the band, or are you going to stay with Metronome? And I guess the fortunate thing was that I had heard the records by then, and after listening to the records, I figured that maybe I had a good chance of becoming a decent writer, since I was not too sure about the drums. He put it right to me at the time, and when I told him, I think I'll stay with Metronome. He looked at me and said, or gave me a look that I was doing the right thing. But I think he at least had the courtesy to offer me the job. Without taking it, I don't know what he would have done.
George, I'll tell you, we could reminisce like this by the hour. It's a pleasure to have had you on the program, and I hope that the next time you're up Hartford way, you'll stop in and we'll do a lot more of this.
I'd love to.
And we enjoyed your big band book thoroughly. Thank you very much, George Simon.
Thank you for what you've done, too.
Stanley Aronson is now a resident of Newington, Connecticut, an instructor at the Hart College in Reeds, and a performer on flute in the Hartford Symphony. And he was one of the veterans of the big band days and a veteran of the old Glenn Miller Orchestra. As a matter of fact, Stan, earlier today you told us about the first time that he pegged you with a nickname, Moose, which still holds on today. What were the circumstances?
Well, Arnold, we had an arrangement on Bugle Call Rag, and as you know, hearing the band, we very seldom played clarinet, other than Willie Schwartz, who played lead clarinet. The rest of us just played saxophone, but on this one arrangement, we had kind of a flair type thing where he went, a big type of thing, and I'd whip the clarinet up and hold it up, you know, and we went through that, and when we finished, Glenn turned to me and said, "You know what? You look just like a moose drinking water playing that clarinet." That's the way it was.
And the name held on. He had nicknames for quite a few of the
everybody.
Players.
He had nicknames for everybody. Yeah, Bulb Nose and Beaver Head. And he had lovely names for people. Very affectionate.
How about a typical day with the Glenn Miller Band? Let's say that you're at a place, the Paradise Restaurant, just as an example, and it's going to be your opening night. What would your typical day be?
Well, most probably we would have gotten into New York from some outer town somewhere and would probably get in about 8 o'clock in the morning usually, and we'd check in our hotel and probably would have a 1 o'clock rehearsal. This would be to set up for the broadcast. Now this was a very meticulous thing with Glenn. He didn't leave this to the people at the studio. He would go to the control rooms, wherever they may be, and he would listen through the microphones. He would listen to us play, and then of course he would start to juggle the musicians around, and we were to have chalk and mark our chairs so that there would be no guesswork as to where we were, and he would have the score in the control room at the studio, and then he would say, "All right, take it from letter A now and let me hear," and he'd say, first saxophone, move back. You're coming in a little too strong. Come, go back." So he'd go back and he'd try it again. "Fine, okay, we're all set up. Now let's try it from letter B and see if we're getting enough bass." And this is the way it would go on, and everything was marked and set up, and that was it.
When he set you up for a 1 o'clock rehearsal, he did mean very definitely 1 o'clock.
Yes, this was something that we were told from the very first day, that when he called a 1 o'clock rehearsal, that meant the downbeat came at 1 o'clock. And if you weren't ready to play, you knew about it. And as we went on, there was a fine system set up so that if you were late, it cost, for a rehearsal, it cost you $10. And when we were in the Paramount Theater, if you missed the show, it was $50. And in those days, $50 was a lot of money.
Well, as a matter of fact, that's about all you were making for a week's work.
Well, not when we hit the Paramount. Then we were making more money than that. But, you know, the pit used to come up. And if you missed the pit coming up on the elevator, then you had to walk in from the wings. And this was very embarrassing to see a musician walk in with his horn and the wings, you know, with his head down, because Miller would probably shoot him dead anyway. So this was, there were tough times. And it was like going to school, really.
Of course, with all of the people in the audience knowing what the arrangement was, there was always a great deal of excitement, I'm sure, with anything that you played. But was there any special favorite?
Oh, In the Mood, I would say, was probably the great favorite of all time.
Thank you. Tex Beneke, how did you and Glenn Miller first get together?
Well, I was working with a band out in Detroit from Texas at that time, Arnold, named Ben Young. And I had played the Texas Centennial in Fort Worth with him when Billy Rose put on the big shows down there back in 1936. And some of our first Eastern engagements were around Detroit and Cleveland. And Gene Krupa was getting ready to organize his first band. He had just left Goodman at that time. And he was, rather than pick up the run-of-the-mill boys that had already had a lot of, been with a lot of bands and things around New York, he was flying all over the country hearing these different bands. He came in to hear us one night, and he took two or three boys, I forgot which now, from the band. We were all on our toes, needless to say, because of the big name that Krupa had, and we all wanted to go with him. But he didn't need a tenor man right at that time. So while they were rehearsing back in New York, Miller happened in at one of Gene's rehearsals, and these boys, he was looking for men too, and these boys that had just left the Ben Young Band recommended me to Glenn. So this is how it all came about.
When you joined the band, had they clicked publicly yet?
Well, he had a band, Arnold, I believe from 36 or 35 to 36, same style. It just didn't make it at all.
Right.
He lost all of his money in that. And then he reorganized in 38 and with a different booking agency backing him. The Shripman brothers out of Boston were handling the band at that time. And the first 3 or 4 months there were pretty hectic, but then they booked us into Glen Island Casino and also over at Frank Daly's Meadowbrook in New Jersey. And we hardly had time to leave the places that we were working in.
Here comes our Tibbet from Texas with a face as long as a panhandle. It's old Texas Beneke singing I'm Not Much on Looks, with Marion and the Modern Airs doing their best to cheer him up a little bit.
On love, I'm just a guy who's kind of shy.
Don't have glamour and such.
I never say much.
But when you start making love,
look out.
I'm not much on looks. I'm nothing rare. Got mussed up hair.
Got a funny grin.
But that isn't thin.
But when you start making love,
look out.
I'm one of those old-fashioned guys who likes homemade apple pie.
You like to come home early, smoke your pipe.
But don't be fooled by the silent type.
You're not much on looks.
I'm just a guy with a crooked tie.
Kinda like it seems.
Not the man of your dreams.
But when you start making love,
look out.
To come home early, smoke my pipe.
But don't be fooled by the silent type.
I'm not much on love. I'm just a guy with a crooked tie.
Kinda like it seems.
Not the man of your dreams.
But when you start making love,
look out.
Better look out. Better look out. Look out.
Afternoon broadcast, night broadcast, and a little bit of everything, but these broadcasts, Coast to Coasters did pay off for him. And after that, why, of course, the band started to skyrocket.
And Glenn Miller was a good organizer in that regard, too. I understand that when he first pressed Tuxedo Junction, for example, he included it every Thursday night in his nationwide broadcast, and that's what helped the record to become a great seller.
Well, I don't remember exactly, Arnold, how often he did it, but he would program certain things quite often if he thought they had potential, you know.
Mm-hmm. Your biggest moment with the band, I would have to say, was with Chattanooga Choo Choo.
I think so, along with the Modern Airs.
Aside, partner, it's my day. Bend an ear and listen to my version
of a really solid Tennessee excursion.
Pardon me, boy, is that the Chattanooga Juju?
Yes, track 29.
Boy, you can give me a shine.
Can you afford to board Chattanooga Choo Choo?
I got my fare
and just a trifle to spare.
You leave the Pennsylvania station about a quarter to four. Read a magazine and then you're in Baltimore.
Dinner in the diner, nothing could be finer
than to have your ham and eggs in Carolina.
When you hear the whistle blowing eight to the bar, then you know that Tennessee is not very far.
Shovel all the coal in, gotta keep it rolling.
Ooh, ooh, Chattanooga, there you are.
There's gonna be a certain party at the station.
Satin and lace.
I used to call Funny Face. She's gonna cry until I tell her that I'll never roam.
So Chattanooga Choo-choo,
won't you choo-choo me home?
Chattanooga, Chattanooga,
get aboard.
Chattanooga, Chattanooga,
all aboard.
Chattanooga, Chattanooga, Chattanooga choo-choo,
won't you choo-choo me home?
Chattanooga choo-choo.
You can still hear the fantastic discipline, how well everyone played together.
Well, we did that. It was like a huge organ, you know. It was so beautifully in tune, and all of the phrasing was so precise, which he insisted upon. He even insisted on the proper and same types of haircuts, and the same socks, and the same handkerchiefs had to be exactly the same in all of our pockets. And we had to sit straight in our chairs with both feet on the floor. And we went in the Paramount, and Glenn gave us 3 days to memorize the whole show, the acts and everything. He says the music stands and music are going out after 3 days. So we had a 4 or 5 week engagement, I believe, maybe longer. And at that time, everything was taken off the stand, and here sat the whole band just playing, cutting the whole show beautifully. And this was, this almost flipped the audience, you know, to see
yes.
That type of thing happen. But when he wanted something done, he always did it right. And I believe that if he had ever come back, that I actually don't think we would have gone through a slump, a so-called slump in the big bands, Arnold. He would have done something to keep things alive.
Personally. Tex Beneke, it's been a great pleasure to talk to you. Thank you so much for helping us with this tribute to Glenn Miller.
Thank you, Arnold.
Now it's medley time, saluting the mothers, wives, sweethearts, and sisters of the boys in the AAF. Something old, something new, something borrowed, something blue. The old song, long, long ago. Sergeant Johnny Desmond sings, "The Music Stopped."
The music stopped, but we were still dancing, which goes to show that music has charms. The lights were low, so we kept on dancing. I felt the glow of you in my arms. The band had left the stand, we were in heaven, dancing on a cloud. But we went on dancing, for we didn't know, because the lights were low and we were in love. We went on dancing, we didn't know we were in love.
A Glenn Miller memorial, an evening with his music and his friends. He left behind more of both than we could ever completely cover as we reminisce 25 years after his disappearance. Glenn Miller, a memorial, was produced by Brian Hartnett and Chuck Reno. Technical assistance by Bill Kaluch, Bob Sharago, and Ben Zinkerman. Thanks also to our guests, George Simon, Stanley Aronson, and Tex Beneke. This is Arnold Dean.